Wednesday, everybody. Short but great show here today, as we are going to do a full hour for you guys, and then we're going to have a little pre-tape that's going to air on Friday. No show tomorrow. I'll let you guys know about that. But today on Collider Live, lots to talk about and some fun people on the desk. As always, the producer extraordinaire, Marcus Reilly, the third junior.
The third?
Junior.
Is correct.
Yeah.
Junior. I like it.
Not a junior. He is the Urban Gladiator, and he's getting back in the ring. We're going to talk about that today. Yeah. Jay Washington is here. What's up, Jay?
I'm happy to be here, especially with all the curtains.
I know, right?
This seems
new.
Like y'all
nice,
do.
Huh?
It looks new here? And like y'all do a lot of dirty photo shoots in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some would say that. Some would just say, no, dirty photo shoots.
Dirty photo shoots.
And by the way, what I have to say is, and something that I would make sure that I didn't want to forget, your hair looks so good.
I knew what
your
you were going to do.
Your hair looks great. It looks great. Why wouldn't you want to take that compliment? It looks great.
Can I tell you guys what happened?
Yeah, because he missed it.
Don't make lies.
Can you tell the people my name?
RJ.
I want them to know.
It's RJ.
It's a people on the
Hold
first
on,
time listeners on
oh, yes, yes,
iTunes.
Yes, yes, yes,
they
yes,
don't
yes.
know who I am.
Okay, sorry. Joining us as always.
Mm-hmm. My name is John Paul Jones.
John Paul Jones is here.
I'm officially John Paul Jones.
JP Jones.
So I.
Roxy Shry.
I saw Christian at a screening last night.
Stuber, which we found out we can talk about.
We did?
We did some research, and I don't know if that's true.
Okay. Well, we can say we saw it.
Yes.
We know that.
We're going to review it, and if we get in trouble, it's
yeah,
his fault.
Sure. So we went to Stuber, and I had seen Christian for the live show in the morning, as you
right.
guys know.
Sure.
And then
it braids, so I didn't really know what your hair was looking like yet.
Yeah,
it could have
and
been
then,
anything.
And then I boy. Went and spent right. like way too much money on going so much blonder, and I got a blowout,
right.
and I did all the stuff.
Sure, like Jay and I do that all the time.
And I told Christian, said, where are you going between here and the screening? I said, right. I'm going to get my hair done.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So then I show up at the screening, and I'm feeling all fresh and good.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting next to Christian.
We had a nice conversation. We were laughing.
Yeah.
Talking about memories past.
Not about my hair, though.
How and then, dare you?
And, but wait,
as
wait,
a man.
No, just wait. Wait for it, though.
Oh, okay.
Mm. And then I turn over to him and say, are you not going to say anything about my hair? And he said, I already complimented it this morning.
Right.
And I said, well, since then, it's changed.
Yeah, but I liked the hairstyle in the morning.
Yeah, and I no longer was in braids.
Here was the difference.
And now I'm policing.
But first of all, what she's not telling the truth about is I didn't compliment her hair yesterday. I complimented her outfit. So that was a blatant lie.
Oh,
right. So the other thing is I didn't see microphones at the movie theater. Right? We weren't on the air.
Right.
I said it today, so everyone knows.
So you're only allowed to compliment me on air?
No, it's not fact. I think that I did compliment your hair yesterday. You're just lying.
Hey,
so
Riley,
now
how
we
do
have
you
a
deal
conversation.
With this?
Yeah,
I just sit here and stare straight forward and,
yeah.
and hope for a quick show.
But
yeah,
I'm
lying.
The one who stares off.
Yeah, look.
Whatever.
Who's texting? You want to make a text?
You want to know who's texting me?
Who's texting you?
The person who's supposed to have a baby today, because I'm a motherfucking birthing doula.
No, you're not a doula.
What are you, Erykah Badu now? The blonde version?
Did you hear about this?
Know.
You're a doula?
She's
I'm
a doula.
Yeah. This is going to be a long
time.
Lots of training.
Today,
I'm a doula.
Hold on.
Can I tell you something? Because you know, you have kids. She's not a doula.
No. I'm a doula.
Do you know who the doula is that she's with?
Who?
A dude.
It's a husband. He asked if I'd be the doula.
So the wife, the
person, she doesn't talk to the wife.
I talk to the wife all the
but
time.
But not about the baby.
Okay.
No, not about the baby. You have conversations about, but you don't. You're
obviously,
not,
I talk to the wife about the baby. You think I told the wife,
you know
don't
what I'm
talk
saying?
To me
a
about
doula,
the baby.
A doula is one who helps with getting prepared for
I'm a doula.
He asked if I would be his doula. He talked to
for
her
him.
About it, and they decided that I would be his doula. So he
his
asked
doula.
Me, and I said yes. So today is the due date, and so we've been texting because they're at the hospital.
You're on call. You're ready for your doulas.
Text them back and say that the people I work with have demoted me, and I am your therapist. I am not your doula.
The people I work with
have demoted me. I am not.
She is literally typing this.
Yeah,
I am not
the definition
not
of what a doula
the
is.
Definition.
So stop calling me doula.
A doula.
Yeah.
I'm a doula.
I'm sure. I'm sure you're a very
spell,
nice.
How do you spell doula?
D-O-U-L-A. Say,
isn't it D-U-L?
D-O-U.
It doesn't matter
anymore.
Anymore.
Fucking no.
I'm sure
I'm
you're
not
a,
the definition of a doula.
No, and I'm sure you're a nice person, but you have to understand the definition.
Okay, now I'm not sending this anymore.
No, okay.
We're deleting it.
I hope we can continue
being
friends through this troubling
time. He says
time.
It's still a waiting game. Guys, they're still in the waiting game.
Okay.
And did she just go because she was due today?
Can
or
I tell you another reason?
Any type of contraction?
Yeah. Due
so
today.
What's the fifth can step I of being a doula when they're in the waiting game? Like
being
this?
At the hospital would be correct. What part would, of being a doula.
Okay. Well, I had to come to work today.
So yeah. You're a terrible doula, is what you're saying.
So you're, I'm supposed to take off work?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. That's you took responsibility a as a doula. You're doula. Not even supposed to be
that's
here. You
job.
Do realize that, right?
They're not paying me.
But you took that responsibility.
Why don't you do your responsibilities?
When you click on the days
do
to
your
take
job,
it off.
Patriots.
Do, yeah.
You know what? He's not even here right now, so I'll just say it. Suck my fucking dick.
Oh,
look
at you. Oh, my
you
goodness.
You're just so hostile with this blonde. Yeah, it's, blonde. It's the blonde hair. Yeah.
What happened, Jay? You're supposed
wonderful.
To come in and have my back.
I have your back in front and everything, but you're not going to be all hostile because you're a doula and not doing your damn job.
I'm doing my job.
Yeah, you're not doing shit. Okay. So Jay's here to talk about a great many things, but we're going to start off with the fact that, and I told him this on the air, and I told I don't know where the hell, maybe I mentioned it on the air yesterday. I'm proud of you that you're getting back in the ring.
Thank
you. I'm also very nervous.
Yeah,
for you.
When you told me that when I was on here last time, yes. You said you were nervous. And I understand why a lot of people were like, yo, you ain't been in the ring in a while. Well, luckily for the past 3-4 weeks, I've been nonstop back in the ring training.
Yeah.
I got my footing back, my timing back, my moveset back. I've added a bunch of other things to the repertoire. I've been working with smaller guys, been working with bigger guys just to keep everything fresh and crisp.
Who's this gentleman you're fighting?
This dude called the heavy hitter Tony Reyes, okay. And I looked at some videos of his.
You've never met this guy?
Never met him, which is cool. Yeah. That normally happens.
Yeah, yeah.
And I watched some videos of him on YouTube, and I was like, oh, I'm beating the shit out of him.
Yeah. Like, I don't like that he has a bat in his hand, though. Is he, they're not going to use shit on you. Like, you're not going to get hit with a bat, are you?
Let me let you in on a secret.
Isn't that illegal?
Not sometimes. No. Depends. Look, Triple H uses a sledgehammer. Right. Now, keep honest.
Oh, my Lord.
But the thing is.
Oh, my Lord.
That was the whitest response I've ever heard from Mark Riley.
Lord.
Oh, my Lord.
Goodness gracious, Jay. Tell me more.
I'm just really worried about you, my friend.
I appreciate it. But now it's cool. It's just that, you know, like, I've had guys who had reputations coming in of being stiff and strong-arming people, and they didn't realize who they were dealing with.
Okay.
So I told them, I'm like, look, I know what your reputation is.
He's got a rep of being stiff?
No, hell no. From his matches, not at all.
Okay.
But I told one dude, I was like, I know your rep. I've seen what you've done. I'm letting you know, you hit me now. You hit me once, we good. You keep hitting me, I'm going to break your fucking jaw.
Go, man.
Then if you try even further, I'm going to shoot you.
Right.
He was like, what? I was like, I'm going to put a bullet in your thigh. And then granted, I wasn't going to really shoot him.
Right.
But that fear of God that I put into him at that moment was like, okay, let me be easy in this ring. And so some guys like to take liberties with guys they don't know if they're the big dog in a company and a Fed, whatnot. But nonetheless, I was watching this match so I can understand where I need to go with my set, with my move set. But this is going to be fun. I'm excited. I'm beyond pumped up for it. Between being in the ring training and being in the gym training nonstop, my legs are like linguine.
Yeah.
Because I've been working, you know, running and getting my cardio up. Because in-shape cardio and ring cardio are two different things.
Is this something that you want to – is this just a one-time thing?
No, not at all.
You're looking to get back in?
Not at all.
Wait, I need to pause because I am so ignorant to this. Are we talking about wrestling?
Professional
right
wrestling,
now?
Yes.
But in professional wrestling that is not the WWE, you guys have never met, so you're not rehearsing?
No.
So you – it.
Here's the thing.
Like, you actually don't know who's going to win.
No, they're going to call spots.
It's called spots.
Can you explain
so
that?
So the thing is called – so wrestling – everybody says it's fake. It's not fake. It's choreographed.
Yeah. Right, but you guys are not going to be choreographed.
We will be to an extent.
It's like almost like improv because they're pros that know how to call spots. So calling spots is that if they're inside the ring, they know certain moves, what they can do. So if Jay – and you'll see people do this in WWE with certain taps or conversations that they can have. Like, let's say I'm with Jay and I mm-hmm. go towards the ring and I say reverse, right? And I'll throw him towards the ring and then he'll reverse me into it. Or it could be reverse miss, and so reverse miss, he can throw me into the ring, and then when he comes to come at me with his elbow, I'll move out of the way. So you know the moves, you've done them
but
enough.
But you have that even with somebody you've never met?
You know how to talk to him in the ring. It's called walking and talking.
Yeah, it's language.
It's something you develop over years to be able to do flawlessly. Because there are a lot of guys who just get in the ring, and girls, who think they can do it, and you watch them mess up. So it's something that takes a lot of training.
So you're just trusting that this dude can do that?
Well, supposedly he's been in 10, 12 years, and if he can't do something basic, then I know to take over the match. Because
which
I have 20.
What?
I know to make sure everything
protect
goes
yourself.
The way. I'm protecting myself. I'm protecting him.
Right.
Because I have damn near 20 years experience. So I know how to make sure, okay, I need you to do this to me. I'm going to do this to you. Lay here. Wait on this. After I do this, this is going to happen.
But let's get back. You literally don't run through one time.
No, not really.
But let's get back. I want to get back to the fact that you. So you say this is not.
I was curious.
That's no problem.
That's fine. But now I want to get back to.
It's not a one-time thing. Only reason, and the reason being is, I've been for the longest talking about getting back in the ring.
Right.
Been a couple of years. It's been a part of me that's been missing. Like I said, I spent 15 years in before I took time off.
Right.
Thank God that my stand-up career, acting, everything started taking off. But there was always a part missing. And I saw a lot of my friends who I've had lifelong friendships with become WWE superstars, Impact superstars, ROH superstars, and now AEW. And once I saw AEW, that brought a resurgence of love to the business as a whole because it lets you know that there isn't just one destination.
Right. So is that the goal? Is that the goal? The goal is to try to get some notice and try to get yourself to one of those places?
Absolutely. And the reason being,
I didn't know that was this is the goal.
Well, here's why. Because I understand being here in Los Angeles, you need to be multifaceted.
Yeah.
I understand that you need to have a fan base that comes from different outlets to come together. And wrestling has already garnered me a fan base that I turned into stand-up comic fans, acting fans. This has brought in people becoming stand-up fans and so on and so forth. I just need that opportunity to put myself on that platform, even if I never get signed a long term, or if I can just get some notoriety behind it.
Yeah.
Like, who would you like to be?
Myself.
Okay, but what kind of career? Whose career would you like to be most?
I think that's a difficult one. For me personally, I want a career where.
Myself. You know,
I know what you're saying.
No, it's such a beautiful answer. Yeah. Who do you want to be? Myself.
Yeah, because so many people try to be other people. I want to be the next Hogan Warrior.
But even the fighting with my family, when they say, don't worry about being the next Rock.
Be the first Paige.
But I don't even mean the next blah, blah, blah. I just mean, are you trying to do the Rock type thing where you would like to then wrestle and then spin that off into more acting? Or
Absolutely.
But the road you're going on right now looks, and off of her question here, it looks like an AJ Styles type of route.
It could be, be that AJ Styles, you have that one good last run, and then from there, what happens, it's open.
Yeah.
The difference is, with AJ, he's never left the ring. I already have my feet planted other places. I've already laid the foundation. So we'll see.
And you think that will be helpful?
Yes. Because now the business is about, the business has always been about putting asses in seats.
Right.
Always. Having a name already somewhat gets people to want to come out to see you.
And the other thing that you have that you've always had, and the day I met you and knew you had it, is that you're brilliant on the mic.
Yeah.
And when it comes to promos and the
thank
thing, you are, you're great at it. And this is the thing. This is the thing with Jay. When I work with Jay on Schmodown, it's sometimes like I want to strangle him, but I always know that he gets. I'll say, because this is what I'll say to him. I'll say, all right, so I got the idea, and before I can finish the idea, he goes, I got you. I'm like, wait, I didn't even tell you what I was gonna say. He goes, no, I got it, and I'm like. Okay, look, then this
as
is...
As opposed to me, where it's, I've got this idea, and I'm like, oh, God, tell me more. But tell Christian's me longer.
Christian's like, okay, because you got a promo. Like, for instance, if Janine has a match, I need you to kind of hit this to set this up, this. I already pretty much know, because we've talked in advance where certain things are going.
To his credit, he hits 98% of everything that I want him to
get. Yeah, because he'll always ask, you just kind of...
You just missed it a little bit. But then with one note, he gets it. And that's the thing, though, that I think that, to be honest, out of the two of these, if in the dream world, I would say that you probably fit right now better in AEW if it all goes for you, because
that's what I would love to do.
If they do what they do, because I don't like script wise, you'd be able to hit scripts.
Yeah.
If WWE, you'd be able to hit scripts. But I just think that what you're so good at is what we just talked about. That if I said, okay, I need you to go over these plot points here, hit those, and then have your own flavor to it, you can.
And
do that
was, and that's what I got from wrestling.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? That's from coming to wrestling to doing this. So it was able to be able to memorize, all right, I need to hit this,
yeah,
without having to look at a sheet of paper. I'm sorry, wake up. I'm sorry, wake up, just wake up. Without looking at a sheet of paper before.
Shaky chair.
But besides, without having, because some people, like a lot of guys in the WWE, what you and the girls, what you don't see is before they do promos, they're in the back like,
say this. Right. They're trying to figure it out.
Couple questions for you, because it sounds like you've got the promo part down, the mic part down. Mm-hmm. I know that you've had a couple of health scares, recently, but in the last few
recent
years.
Enough?
Recent enough. Yeah, that's what I was last year.
Is that getting you afraid to get back?
Absolutely not. I think I've learned to, first off, I'm grateful to God, as I've always said, that I'm here. And my health scare with having the surgery that saved my life with the tracheostomy is actually the best thing that happened for me.
Yeah.
And I say that because I ended up losing 41 pounds in a week in the hospital. After that, I ended up changing my whole diet, my workout routines. I'm in the best shape of my life. And so to know nothing's going to hit, like, puncture a hole in my throat or give me an abscess in my neck.
Right.
I'm good on that end.
Well, don't let that guy hit you in the throat with a bat.
Yeah, I'm not taking that at all. That's something I know.
Right.
But it's those things I don't worry about and focus on. I've had a lot of things. I've had the shoulders injuries. I've had the concussions. Those are part of the business, unfortunately. So I don't worry so much about those. I understand with major injuries, like you're saying, people are like, oh, aren't you concerned that may happen and whatnot?
Right.
I'm not. I'm pretty much comfortable in knowing what I should take, what I shouldn't take, what I should do, what I shouldn't do, how I can allow certain things to happen to avoid that.
Well, the other thing that I was going to say is that, and this is something, so last night after I complimented Roxy's hair, she started.
It's not what happened.
I think it's what happened.
He said nothing.
Well, we started looking at
$200 I'll never see again.
Well, it's not my fault. So we were looking at the Facebook group and Schmodown, and there were some polls out there. It was like that basically said if you were voting for Player of the Year right now,
Manager of the Year.
There were a bunch. The start of the Player of the Year was one of the Rookie of the Year was the other one. Rookie of the Year was between Smets and Oyama.
You trying to pick a fight with me today?
This is not for you. I promise you, this is not for you. And then there was Teams of the Year. There was Manager of the Year, and I did show Roxy, and Kaiser is in the lead at the moment. And she said, "Are you kidding?" And I was like, "What?" And she's like, "You actually have to manage your players, right, in order to and because Roxy and I said this, and if you go in that group, there was a paragraph of what I said about you as far as being a manager goes." And I was like,
I saw that.
I said, Roxy is the most, she is locked into the game. She is supportive of her players. She gets them calm. I had your back tremendously on this post, but it's not you that I'm talking about here. Because on this particular post, which is a fair debate for fans, because the fans need to be treated like sports fans because they're allowed to talk as long as they're respectful enough, right? Is that what happened yesterday?
Here's what it is. For the past 2-3 years, we've been doing the awards for voting and all that. I've been quote unquote up for Manager of the Year in nomination, just like all the managers are. I have specifically said, don't even nominate me because I know I'm not going to win. Last year, I was furious. I was like, I came back a week after almost dying to manage Janine on her first victory. He was like, "Well, that's not enough. Are you fucking serious?" And so
you were close.
When Fife is in the running, it's impossible.
It's impossible. Now this year,
you were close.
I'm not saying that she's a better manager than us, because I still think I'm the best manager there is. But Fife is an incredible. She's so likable.
Fife took Cushing, Wolf to title shots, and Draco to a title shot, and she won the title.
I took a rookie his first year to the title,
and she's lovable.
But there's two things with that. You came close. You were two into it.
Yeah.
But you also he had a run before he joined you.
Yeah, Fife is
okay.
You see what
fair, I'm fair. Yeah. Okay, but still,
super knowledgeable.
And then it was
the
this
game.
Year, and I was it was like, well, if Oyama wins the title, Kaiser's a lock. And I was like, hey, don't put me in that. And so I told Christian this. I was like, yes, to quote Christian Harloff, I was a little butthurt. I was a little butthurt.
And I looked at him and I said,
fair. He's like, fair. That's all it was. Yeah. And so Christian was like, you just can't. I was like, I was a little butthurt,
yeah.
Okay?
Because so
I'm like, I
that
know.
Because
I know what I do for Janine and then Ethan. Think about it. Ethan's whole personality has changed.
A billion
yes.
percent.
Ethan's yes.
I will
yes.
give you that, too.
Yeah.
And especially, like, the live performance
yes.
with Janine. I mean, I don't even know if she would have. And I love Janine. I don't even know if she would have gone on stage without you. Like, I don't even know if
probably
she.
Not.
You,
probably not.
Probably
not. She was so flipped.
A lot of fans still don't see that, though. And they ask, I've gotten people ask me, like, what do managers do?
People don't see 90% of my job.
Yeah.
And also, like, from the wheel to fighting for different slices to making sure that they feel confident. To managing their
teaching new players the game,
their drinking and smoking habits.
Yeah.
So are you talking about Jeff Snyder in particular?
I'm just saying, like,
he is, shocker. Is Jeff Snyder not John Moxley?
Yes, he is the John Moxley of the
smoker. You guys are seeing partial outfits. Imagine if I wasn't there when you guys were oh God!
Yeah, I'm sure.
I mean,
he's
in
the ideas.
Like, no, God.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying I don't let him do what he wants because as a manager,
but
you have
suggestions.
Uh huh.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
What I said to Jay was, I was like, it's the fan base and they're allowed. They should be able to talk and debate it. And he's like, yeah, they should. He's like, but.
My
feelings were hurt. I said, that's fair.
I just think that this, and I know you said this isn't for me, but I'm going to take it anyway.
Okay, sure.
I just think that this Kaiser conversation doesn't make any sense.
Okay.
Because I'm not doubting his players.
Right. There's no doubt behind Smets and Oyala. Right. There's no doubt behind them.
But you like Phil Jackson managed the Bulls to the championship. You know, is he the greatest manager of all time?
Yeah,
coach of all time.
He is, technically. He was the one who, Scotty!
But he had Jordan and Scotty.
But he was calling plays that they were running. If they were managerless, I swear they'd be doing as well.
They'd be doing the same thing.
And my players would not be. They would not be doing as well. And I love them, but they could not communicate for absolute crap.
Ethan Irwin would be the dude we saw that first time he came. Everybody's like, okay, he's good, but it's just like he's just there.
Right.
100%. If you aren't changing your players for the better and you're globbing your name onto theirs for brand marriage, then you're not doing your job.
The debate begins halfway through the season. I love it.
If he was doing his job, then like the things that I've talked about, you'd be more supportive about him going on his diet, his exercise routine. And I'm sorry, but if you guys saw that live show, then you would know that if you had a better manager, it probably wouldn't end the same way that it did because somebody tells you to take their time.
Well, I would love for you guys to go on over and vote because the polls are there. You listen to both Jay and Roxy's argument too. Go on over to the Movie Trivia Schmodown Facebook group and join today. But let's move on to some other stuff here too. Roxy did mention that we saw Stuber last night, and that's the new Dave Bautista movie. And
Kumail Nanjiani.
Yeah, Kumail Nanjiani. So here's the thing with him last night. Because I really liked Big Sick. So this movie, and I think you and I felt the same way. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I think we laughed at the same time. We felt the exact same way about almost every part. Too.
So there's some times in this movie that Camille is doing these jokes and they just fall flat. And almost to the point where he was annoying me. And I'm like, dude, this character is bad.
I think that's a writing thing, though. It wasn't his delivery was bad.
There was some delivery in the car at one point that I was just like, he's trying so hard for these jokes and they're bombing. And then the
flip
side of that.
Maybe directorial, though. I don't know.
To me, it was delivery as far as comedic timing and everything. And what he was doing, he was just annoying. But then the following scene would hit and he's killing me. Like, in a good way. Crying laughing at some of the things he was saying. He was so, like, it was like 50-50. And he was, but to his credit, he was taking shots at every moment he could.
Oh, okay.
And so he's firing.
I love that about him.
Me too. Good. Me too.
And he took every shot he could.
Every shot that he could. And it's like that basketball player just firing up threes.
Kobe Bryant.
They're banking off. They're bricking sometimes, but then there's other times it's a switch.
Yeah. See? Kobe
and
Bryant.
He doesn't stop even if he just missed. He's like, all right, next one.
I was supposed to have been at that screening with y'all. I signed up. I RSVP'd. I was like, I was going to see Stuber. And then as time went down, I was kind of like, yo, I didn't get to go see Far From Home. And it's out. So I went to the theater by my house to go see Far From Home. And guess what? Clearly, I made a better choice with my evening.
Well, I don't know.
No. Stuber's good. It's not great. It's funny enough.
I'm not saying in comparison. Right. I love Far From Home because of what, like, everybody knows what I do with the comic book movies and TV shows. But it was an expectation for that. And hearing how you guys are like, he was trying too hard at some point.
Sometimes, but like I said.
No, but that's any movie in a sense, though. Yeah. You have some comedians, who just try hard for everything.
You know what it was, though, this movie to me seems like a movie that for some reason, and I say this, like The Rock and Kevin Hart passed on.
Yeah.
Right? But.
100%.
But if you put the two of them in there and said, well, you could have had The Rock and Kevin Hart in this, who would you have? I would take Bautista and Camille.
Yo, Bautista's great.
Bautista really delivers
so
in this role. First of all, the movie is like a hard R. There's a lot of like John Wick type violence in this movie.
Really?
Yes.
Jesus.
And it opens up
right away. Right from the top, yeah.
Right from the top. You know that this is going to be a violent movie. And he might be the worst cop in the world because the things that he gets this Uber driver involved in this thing to where he's like, I'm paying for it. You got to get involved in this drug bust. What? This guy could get killed.
But like at some points he cares and some points.
Yeah.
There was a lot of the parts of the movie. You have to just say K because it's so stupid at times that you just have to say it's one of those movies where this is I can't rationalize 50% of the things going on, so I'm just going to go with it because it's funny.
I agree. I had a fun time watching the movie, and I was talking to Perry about this, too. I don't think this is a movie that I would tell people, you have to see this movie in the theater.
Okay.
I mean, you've got to. I think it's a movie that actually you enjoy more if you popped up. Oh, it's on Netflix today.
And you're super baked.
And you're baked, and you watch it. Because I thought their chemistry is great.
I just want to say, before we go any further, that is something we've never used back home in the hood.
What's
being
that?
Baked. Like nobody, no. Everybody say, as long as you hide shit. Like, you know, okay.
Just terminal. The
what, you don't word, like babe? Getting baked?
Yeah.
I mean,
hey, know. Me and my friend just stoned out of our tits.
See?
Like, I like weed.
Yeah. Yeah. High shit. Like,
honestly, especially being from my people, it's probably not a term that I should use, but.
Yo, I'm fucked up.
But I, what I mean is high. So yes. Just to
I know
be
what you know. I know what you mean.
Shit.
Yeah.
Sorry,
yeah.
It no. Just got yeah. Real.
Play that 420 music. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Okay. All right. Now
Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal. Taj.
Bachman.
No, huh? Is he so high?
Who's yeah.
It?
Oh.
What is it?
Let's get
I think
back.
It's Bachman.
Taj Bachman?
Hold on. Taj Bachman sounds like an old school, like 1700s
it's
composer.
It's Tal Bachman.
Tal
oh, well,
Bachman.
He doesn't.
There we go. We Tal. Got there.
Oh, I call them Taj Mahal. His that's real, great. Yeah.
That's good.
In the last minute of the show, did some, this is the I last would like show. To hide under the table.
Yes, you're right.
It's your
Roxy's,
show.
Roxy's worst moments me. Have just come from one episode right here.
Somebody stop it. It's coming out too quick.
To your last show. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
It was very nice knowing you.
Your hair looks great.
The blonder I get.
The blonder. Right. You have excuses now.
Wow.
Yeah. The other thing, just to, before we jump into the movie news that I want to talk to you about that I have you here is... I think it was a month. When the hell was it? Last week, whenever they announced Paul Heyman and Bischoff.
Bischoff taking over Raw and SmackDown.
It looked like from Raw this past Monday that we're starting to get the idea of what it's going to look like because some shit went down.
It looks like it, but like Ryan and I were talking about, and Ryan I even Satin. Was talking to Ryan Satin, yeah, who from Pro Wrestling Sheet, and some other people I know on the inside, even were like, that's not Heyman. Vince McMahon booked the show like Paul Heyman was running it.
Yeah.
Also, the very first holy shit moment we saw with the stage, they're tearing.
And they said holy shit.
Right. Yeah. They're tearing it down. They're giving a new, getting a and new Raw stage.
And they needed a way they to, needed a to reason replace to, it.
Yep.
I like that they did it that way.
Because normally you just see a new stage pop up and you're like, oh, yeah. So that's
so,
what this is?
So what happened, so let you guys in on it, is that, so Braun Strowman, who's like this like 6'7", just monster. They
country
call him
strong
monster.
Bastard.
Yeah, they call him, and now he's like jacked. He just was a big dude. Now he's like all cut up.
Uh-huh.
So Braun Strowman and Bobby Lashley, who was an MMA fighter, but he was a wrestler back in the day. He fought in that WrestleMania with Trump back in the day.
Yep.
And he's this jacked dude. So they were fighting in a no-holds-barred kind of false count anywhere match. At the end of the night, the end of the match, they're up on the Titantron there, the ramp that goes up to it, and the big display of like
the LED screen.
So Braun Strowman's by the ramp, and he runs at him at Bobby Lashley and tackles him through the actual screens, breaks it. There's electricity going everywhere, and that's exactly what the announcer said.
Yeah.
He said, "Holy shit!" off camera, and it's what they did for about 15 minutes instead of doing one of those ridiculous. Nonsense, bullshit, overwritten scripts that they do for 15 minutes.
They showed you them getting loaded in my medical teams.
They held on a camera as if like there was actual ambulance people coming in, medical stuff, and there was nothing that was being said, and it looked real. And even so, Ricochet is this new up and coming wrestler who I love. He's probably one of my favorite new guys.
Mad that a lot of people are just not finding out about him.
He's great. I mean, I watched him in NXT also, but he's on the backstage interview, and this goes off of what Jon Moxley was talking about, the kind of stuff that they hope that they do. There was this interview that he gave, and it didn't seem scripted. He seemed like he was just being interviewed in the backstage, you know, and he had stumbled over his words a couple times too, but it seemed raw and real.
But that's what you need. That's what you need.
Yes.
You have a lot, again, it's promos. They tell him, we need you to say this. But some people, you start to tell them, hit these points.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I guess they decided to trust him and see what he could do. Because he probably told him, I can do what you need me to do. Just tell me what to do.
Right. Because the angle with him and AJ was great.
Right. But it's also like, okay, you need to be able to say this. You need to be able to do this. Can you deliver on this? This is your one shot to do
it. And he did it.
And he did it. So.
Yeah.
And that's like with promos, again, we do in the Schmodown. Me and Jen Sturgeon were like, we want to hold a symposium on promos. For some people.
To the rookies,
To the rookies primarily because...
And she said she wants to do that more so than not just the promos, but like in general.
Just
kind
in
of
general.
Yeah.
Because it's
what's
like...
the problem? People are using the backstage area? Or the,
not
the,
even that.
Makeup room or something?
Not even that.
It was, right?
Everybody doesn't need to wear sunglasses. Oyama is one of the main ones. Like you don't... I understand the lights thing, but what's the point? At some point after you played your first game, you don't need them anymore.
I feel like you shouldn't be able to wear them unless you've been in the league for at least a year and a half.
Right. You haven't earned that right.
That's a good rule.
Well, because honestly, really like, there's too many comments about where they're looking. And you need to earn those stripes.
Sunglasses?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm not questioning them.
I'm learning how to stand in post interviews.
Yeah.
Because I love Jen. Like, everybody
don't know
knows
what to
me
do
and
with
her.
My hands.
I don't know what to do with my hands. Also, it's Jen. I love everybody know me and Jen are like brother and sister, damn near. Stay out of her light. Like, she works hard on her makeup.
Yeah.
Like, but any woman who is in that light, you need that light.
Right,
so, like, you'll have people just, like, stepping right there and turning. It's like, no, have your position.
The problem is with that, too, is that I've been – because what I've been doing, you'll notice it more and more on the upcoming matches is – and by trusting people like Roxy and Danielle Radford and new people that are coming in that are killing it, it allows me to then go off and shoot scenes and do things too.
Run ragged over that end.
Yeah, if I'm not but if I'm not inside, sometimes I usually watch over the post and because now I trust Jen to where she can do it.
Yeah.
But a lot of times with the new people, I don't have. She says to me, she's like, I need you there sometimes to give them
to
notes.
Guide them where to go.
There's been a lot of rookie mistakes this year.
Yep. Yeah.
But we'll figure it out. And the same thing, they're figuring it out in Raw. And it looked like it's a new
good
change.
Segue.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, let's move into movie news. And there's a lot of shit going down, Riley. We have
lots
a lot of stuff
shit.
Here. Let's talk about this this Flash thing.
Crazy.
Up top.
Yeah, let's do it.
What's going on?
THR dropped this yesterday, and it looks like IT director Andy Muschietti is in talks to take over the Flash. I know, right? The deal
you like
has
this, you don't like this. You don't think it's
this
real.
This is fantastic for
I
me.
I love this.
I don't know.
It's not a problem with Andy Muschietti.
You just
not,
don't know if it's going to happen.
It's just the
Flash.
It's just the Flash. This is like the fifth or sixth directorial choice we've had in four years.
I think it's actually fourth, but yes.
Okay, no. Fourth. I'm sorry.
No,
yeah,
that's true.
Because Rick Fumiyama, there was somebody else, and then there
Seth
was...
Seth Graham's...
Francis Daley.
And Jonathan Goldstein were the most recent ones.
The first, though, before Fumiyama was Seth Graham... God, Smith, thank you.
Oh yeah, it was one before Rick. I mean, so it's like this thing keeps getting cursed, and at some point, nobody's gonna really care because they keep rewriting scripts.
Well, until it actually starts to go into production. Now, but here's the thing. So the reason why I think this is probably the most realistic is.
Because of IT and him being in Warner Brothers.
And he's got Warner Brothers. Yeah. And because he's also got a proven hit in the first movie. And now the second movie, I'm not a horror fan. It's one of my most anticipated movies all year.
I want to go to see IT Chapter 2, but I only want to go with Winston Marshall. Kind of how like y'all went with Josh McCougar.
Does he get scared?
He gets totally scared.
Why don't we send him and McCougar together?
You know. They'll never see anything on the screen.
McCougar's already going.
But it would be best to see it because, like,
what's wrong, Marcy?
I just think that we're burying the lead here.
What's the lead?
Which is that Ezra Miller is still attached to this movie.
Which doesn't.
It's not about the director for me. It's just so baffling that Ezra Miller is still attached to this movie.
Well, let me finish.
Again, he's already in Warner Brothers' family with Fantastic Beasts.
Well, I want to hear your point.
We have lost Ben Affleck. We know that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Henry Cavill, we probably do not have anymore. Ezra Miller, his contract as well as Ray Fisher's is up, and he was penning a script to make sure that he would be able to stay in this. And now we have this announcement. So I'm wondering, does that mean that they liked his script and then took director?
He's changing it.
They changed the script.
So then why is he still attached to the project?
I think he'll be announced out eventually.
Listen, no.
He has to.
So listen to who they attached to write it now.
We have a new writer, Christina Hodson, who is doing. She wrote Bumblebee. She's writing Birds of Prey. She's writing Batgirl. She is now like the IT writer.
So the Miller script didn't work.
They still have him attached.
And you know what Miller? The problem with Miller's script too, because he brought Grant Morrison in, which is cool. The problem was he tried to make the Flash darker.
Mm-hmm.
He said that, which is the dumbest.
And that was going against the director's vision.
And plus, you've already been a goofy Flash. Like, you can't just all of a sudden spin it on his head and say, this whole movie's going to be dark. That just doesn't work.
They need to ditch Barry Allen. They have to ditch Barry Allen and go with Wally West and not have Ezra Miller be in there.
I mean,
we need a different Flash.
Reestablish your universe. That's what you're doing anyway. Mm-hmm. The only two safeguards they
have. And we can't just
have
another Barry Allen in this universe. Okay, so if we're not retconning it, Barry Allen's busy. He's off doing something else. We bring in Wally West. It's a new actor. We have our new Flash. And
you have to establish, in a sense, the only problem with that is you have to establish where Wally comes from and how you get a kid Flash. I get what you're saying.
You could do it in 2 seconds. You could do it in one line, one scene.
Yeah, they could. I mean, they could, but
we have an incredibly successful Barry Allen on the TV show right now. He's ridiculously good. Everybody loves Grant Gustin. I don't know anybody who watches the show. You don't like Grant Gustin?
Oh, I don't have a problem with Grant on the show. I just know about Grant behind the scenes.
What's that?
Oh, yikes.
So I get...
I don't even want to hear this.
So what is that? I get, again, doing
is
Mad Tiger...
Is this hearsay or is this is true? No,
this is from actual crew members.
Okay. I have heard from literally every crew member he is the best. I can't believe this.
I've heard from some... Well, I've heard he just is like... He's gotten that ego because he's that far along. Okay. But which is warranted. You 5-6 years
See,
in.
See, I've heard that many times about Stephen Amell, but I have never heard that.
I've definitely heard that about
Grant.
Amell, too, which is like your last 8th season. Goodbye if you're like that.
But we don't know any of this.
But also, the one of the things for a fact with Grant Gustin was he doesn't like wearing the suit. You were only cast to be the Flash. That's why if you see him with the suit on, he'll never put the cowl on sometimes. That's why they did a whole 2-3 episodes with Barry Allen in prison so he didn't have to wear the suit. You're the Flash. Mm. That's what you're supposed to be.
I think it's a preference. I don't think it's I will not wear this suit. I think it's, I prefer not to, because it's probably sweaty as shit, uncomfortable.
I mean, of course, it more than like all the suits. Cress Williams tells me all the time how the Black Lightning suit is uncomfortable. But that's what you were cast for.
Remember when we had the guys in here that said that they were literally agony
tech,
dying?
The tech, yeah.
That it was brutal.
But so, I mean, it's just, but he is a great Barry Allen on screen. He is a great Barry
That's
Allen.
What I'm just... All I'm saying is not talking about Grant Gustin off screen.
No, I got what
I'm
you're
just saying.
Saying
he is an amazing Barry Allen. Ezra Miller, for me, never did it as Barry Allen. I love Ezra Miller, but I think he should have been a Grant Gustin in the first place. But now that we didn't do that, if we finally have new directors and a new script coming, we need a new actor
and probably
a new Flash.
I agree with you on that.
All right, well, cool. Well, we're going to find out. We'll find out. I think this story is far from over, to quote the great Frank Stallone. Far from over, Frank Stallone.
Right, far from home.
Far from over. It's a 1982 song from Staying Alive.
Far from home, Spider-Man.
That's too recent. All right, moving on to something that I want to talk
about
now. Here.
Jay Washington.
Yeah.
I made a decision. I'm going to bring in the Terminator footage to San Diego Comic-Con. I'm going to put it on the screen.
You're doing Arnold.
I'm going to put it on the screen, and I'm going to say... What do you think here? Do you think this is something that the Deadpool...
Show him another 20 minutes.
Tim Miller. Show the whole fucking movie. Show it.
Show the movie.
Come on.
Linda's back.
What do you got to do? And by the way, your hair looks wonderful.
You need to get that. Now that this has happened, you need just that part cut out as a sound bite. Yeah, it looks wonderful. I mean, of course, it's expected.
Like the end of
but they said he was... I was talking when I did...
I thought Fox wasn't going to be there.
Well, which
is Fox?
This?
Paramount.
This is Paramount. This isn't Fox. Yeah,
Top Gun's going to be there.
Right,
so
right.
Might as well have Dark Fate.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Moron.
Who? Me? Because I didn't know. Sorry. Taking shots.
If you're a studio, you know Warner Brothers film is not there. You know Disney's film is not there. Marvel is there. This is a chance to make a splash. Yeah, yeah. So why not use Dark Fate?
Why are you saying Disney's film is not there?
Because they're going to be a D23.
Yeah, doing Marvel.
They're just doing Marvel.
Yeah, okay.
That's what he meant. He meant more than Disney.
Yeah, no Disney movies. They're all going to be D23.
Right, like Pixar and all that
stuff. Yeah, all
that's
D23, yeah.
But it makes a lot of sense because this is the movie that they need to shift around. This is their last shot as far as Terminator goes. This is their last shot. If this movie, because Tim Miller wants to do a trilogy.
If this
you ain't
going to
get a trilogy if this movie isn't good.
I'm so excited for Mackenzie Davis.
I like her
love
a lot.
Her. Yeah. She, to me, is the next big thing.
I just want to see. I was very excited, and I always reference the big man. we were both really pumped for this movie because he told me he got a chance to see the panel. Listening to both Tim Miller and Cameron talking about it, and he told me, he's like, dude, it's like, because he and I loved the first Terminator because it was like a horror movie.
Yeah,
and
it was.
He's like, they're going back to basics, and even doing the anthem, but going back to basics, and I was just so pumped for it. When I saw that trailer, though, the little mini trailer, I didn't get that vibe. I didn't like the trailer, but I also didn't see the amount of stuff they showed at CinemaCon.
So I don't know much about Mackenzie Davis aside this. I like what I saw in the trailer. I'm pumped to see what Gabriel Luna can bring to this.
Because
I've been sold on him for a minute, especially him being Robbie Reyes now. So and Linda Hamilton being back, like that one trailer thing where she was on the Humvee that was hanging from the aircraft carrier, whatever it was, the plane. I was like, are you serious? That's the only thing that didn't look believable.
I don't want him to do the Die Hard 4 stuff to where it's like the reason why the first one was it was a simple horror sci-fi movie, mm-hmm. and it worked. The second one was definitely, and that's a lot of people's favorite, is the second one.
Yeah.
And it was one of the big blockbusters, but it was still a simple premise. It was still a very simple premise. Don't overcomplicate it. Don't overdo it with CGI, which is what it looked like in the trailer. Don't overdo it. Like, just
With Gabriel Luna's Terminator, you kind of have to have a lot of CGI with that.
I can stand that stupid shit that they did with what he's coming through.
Whereas you have to
do it every time, though. There's a new Terminator, and it just gets old, and that's what got me with this one.
I would have been cool.
Just all of a sudden, it's like, oh, we have a new Terminator. How many new Terminators?
I would have been cool with T-800. I would have been totally cool with that.
Yeah, I always said, why not go back to the basics? Yeah. Like the first movie where Skynet is like on its last leg and they send in one last T-800 or something.
It
could have been like a callback to the original. Yeah. But we have a new Terminator. It does look fine, the effects, but yeah.
Imagine they would have done the type of budget that they did for like this new the Halloween that just passed, right? Like that kind of tone to it. If they would have done that for Terminator,
yeah.
Like to me, like you don't need to go over because of T2. Like they always realize they have to capture a blockbuster.
T2 and James Cameron as a whole.
But he's only producing it. He's producing.
But that's all him being a producer. Even though he's not the director, he has a lot of say. So you should do
he's
this.
Collecting checks, dude.
He went on the record for Genesis saying it's one of the best Terminator movies.
Right.
And that's him. That's
and
input.
He got paid $1 million. Yeah, for
but that's. I mean, he's still getting paid. But that's that input. Like maybe if we go bigger with this and smaller with that. And, yeah. That's what you get.
I don't know if he's given any notes. Maybe he is. I mean, the only reason I'd say that he might be more involved in this one is because of the addition of Tim Miller and mm-hmm. everything that Tim Miller has. Tim Miller is a fan. I mean, Tim Miller is a very creative dude, and he's a good director. And you can't judge the full movie off the trailer. It's just the tone that I got after hearing everything about the movie and what they saw at CinemaCon was Terminator's back. I didn't get that from the last trailer. But I hope that the movie itself delivers.
Put the music in it, damn it.
That's what bothered me in the trailer. Where's the Brad Fidel score?
Seriously.
What if we get it in the second? What if the next trailer gives it? Because we talked about this on
Put
Movie
it
Talk.
In the movie, though.
No, gotta be in the movie. It's like it gives that flavor.
Yeah, I know.
And then it fills in some of the blanks.
They don't want to pay Brad Fidel. They've done this in every freaking movie since the second one. Oh. Why do you not have Brad Fidel score? It is iconic.
Yeah.
So stupid.
That's a Paramount thing, then.
It is.
That's a Paramount thing.
Oh, yeah. They don't want to pay him.
Exactly.
Pay him the money.
That's what Marvel was doing for so many years until they brought back Sylvester.
Yeah.
Well, because Perlmutter got out of there. He was the guy that didn't like scores. And Feige's always been the guy. As soon as Perlmutter was out of there, Feige's like, get Silvestri back. Let's get the theme. He gets music.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I'm hoping that they use the Brad Fidel score. We'll see. All right. Anything else that we should talk about here in particular?
I think there's an interesting story that just broke, and that Amazon's Lord of the Rings series is now heating up. We got J.A. Bayona is going to direct two episodes for Amazon series.
Like
this is from Deadline. That is a great call. Are you kidding me?
I think you could have said it better.
But also, you got to have a top-tier director. How much money are they dropping into this series? Like almost $1 billion, something like that? So you need a top-tier director. Bayona works perfectly to do this.
Is that a real number that you just pulled out?
It's stupid high. I know whatever they're putting behind this. It's dumb.
It's got to be. Listen in this report.
You want to do it justice
$1 billion.
They dropped. I don't know if it's maybe a bill, but I know it's a ridiculous high number. That maybe $100 million. I'm sorry, maybe $100 million. Yeah. But they're dropping $100 million into this series.
Right. Well, that's back
at that point. What's zero?
Well, you know what's crazy though is 2000. This shows you how expensive the show is. In 2005, Rome, which I think is one of the most underrated shows of all time, and it's essentially the casting of that. If you see, you see a lot of Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones is essentially Rome in the fantasy world. that show back in 2005 cost $100 million to make, and that was unheard of. Right now. A lot of these shows, like The Mandalorian, is going to be in that range. And if you look at it, it's basically an 8-hour movie that costs $100 million.
Mm-hmm.
That's not too bad.
Yeah, because think about it, we get 2-hour movies that cost $100 million. Yeah,
shit, man. Avengers Endgame was like $300 million.
Yeah, that was $100 million per hour.
But it was $300 million. And so if you do Jurassic Park, should be $100 million series. And J.A. Bayona doing this, what I like about him is A Monster Calls and Fallen Kingdom or whatever, the Jurassic World, such different movies in tone, and you could see that he knows how. I didn't like Jurassic World, his movie.
I didn't, because I thought it was three different movies.
I thought it was three different movies. But here's the difference, though. That opening scene that he shot was brilliant.
Oh, yeah, the opening was one of the best scenes. I mean, if the movie stayed on that line.
My problem was the script. The script was really bad, and because the stuff he directed, and it looked really cool, too. I just, the script was really goofy. But I have confidence in it there was a lot of silly humor in that movie too. I think that him doing these two, I'm on board with it. Roxy, what do you think?
Yeah, I completely agree. I don't think there's a name that could have gotten me more excited for this. Lord of the Rings is not my
bag of tea.
No, I love it, but of all the franchises, it's not the one that I know the most about. I just casually watch them because I am a fan, and I think that I'm in a good spot going into this because of that. Yeah. Because if you're attaching somebody I like, I'm into it.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I don't know, there might be some diehard Lord of the Rings fans out there right now who had their eye on a specific director and they didn't get that person.
I bet
whatnot.
You Rachel Cushing loves this call.
You think so?
Yeah.
I bet she loves it.
Yeah.
There's a lot of love happening online for this. I would love to see what Rachel thinks. Yeah, this is great. And
did The Orphanage, too. Wow, I love that movie.
The Orphanage is one of the best horror movies.
I don't know.
It's a short
movie. The Orphanage is another one that's really
underrated. The Impossible? Are you kidding me? The Impossible is so good.
I love all his movies except the Fallen Kingdom one.
Monster Calls is beautiful,
Monster Calls is great. The Impossible is freaking...
It's so underrated. A lot of people don't... Yeah. It's
Tom Holland, Ewan McGregor.
Ewan McGregor, Naomi Watts.
You ever seen it?
No.
Oh, dude.
I've never seen it.
It's a crazy movie. It's about the tsunami that hit. During boxing.
Yeah.
Wow, he directed Night Work and Seance and Penny Dreadful. I didn't know that either.
It's based on the experience of Maria Bellon and her family in the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami. The cast includes Naomi Watts.
I remember that because when it broke, they started showing you like, wait, what?
Yeah. It's some of Ewan McGregor's best acting, for sure. And it was the one that made me, I remember when they started rumoring Tom Holland for Spider-Man, and I was like, that's the kid from The Impossible.
Mm-hmm.
He's great in that movie. All right, anything else that we should move on to here, or should we take some phone calls?
Let's get some phone calls, yeah.
All right, cool.
We got some good news that happened already.
Yeah, we had some good news that happened already?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm so fucking tired.
What does that mean?
I cannot... I have been sitting here. Did you see that?
No,
I want to show you this first.
Stop. We're not moving on. Yeah. What does we've got some good news that happened
here? I wanted to say that was some good news. We can move on.
Yeah.
It came out the other way, Roxy. Because
we got some good news.
You're talking about like I'm sitting here listening to Jay talk about wrestling.
I get it all the time. You get it all the time.
But no, I'm sitting here listening to Jay talk about. He's back in the gym. He's going back.
Good news that happened here.
And I rolled out of bed this morning and hurt my back. Oh. I mean, it's just like I am.
Why you said it though? And I'm sorry. I've been trying so hard to swallow this, but I cannot.
Yeah.
I literally feel like I could pass out. It's so hot in here.
It is hot.
Like your brain is literally.
Well, I'm staring.
If the air conditioner goes on, that's some good news that will happen here.
I could not. That's so true. I literally could not even contribute to the conversation.
That's why I've been drinking these aminos to stay awake.
I had so much more to add in about Linda Hamilton, but I was tapped.
Well, I know. We've got 15 minutes to get a breath, and that. Get some air, and that would be some good news.
That was some good news that happened here.
Because that one.
Some good news happened here.
But wait, I do want to show this.
What?
Yes. Let's go to this video.
You've heard about the bottle cap challenge, right?
Yeah. Kicking the bottle of the thing?
Yeah.
Watch this video.
Okay.
This is incredible.
Jason Statham. Let's see. Can we zoom this?
Yeah, this video is bomb.
Look at this guy.
Yeah, he's great.
How many tries do you think this was?
One.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, it was one.
Know what?
Yeah, that's one. Because I saw, see how.
Okay, so you think that's the best? Donnie Yen just beat everybody's because he did it blindfolded.
No, really?
Okay. Donnie Yen is the nobody. Jason Statham is cold, but Donnie Yen is blindfolded and just goes.
There he is right there. Okay, he's putting the blindfold on.
Oh, boy.
Because he knows exactly where to put his foot. Yeah, look at that.
Oh, my God.
He's so good. Donnie Yen. Look at him.
He's the best.
Look, my thing is that this challenge, the only reason I think that it's not a big thing.
Because everybody can't do it.
Because Frosty, Heidi, and Frank, to which is the local radio station that I do every Thursday.
I'm obsessed with that.
They had the whole crew doing it outside of the office. And Sammy, who is their producer, she's like 5 foot one, and she had like, I don't even know what she was wearing. She's like, I had sandals on, and looked just like Statham's. And then, really? And then they had, and Heidi did it, and then Frank did it. Frosty, though,
how did it look just like Statham's?
The roundhouse. She did the roundhouse kick. The thing came off it. Then three other people did the exact same thing. It wasn't, if she had just did it, I'd be like, whoa, Sammy did it too, just like Statham.
Everyone did it?
Everyone did it, except Frosty, and not Frosty Weintraub, Frosty on their show. Frank. And it's actually really funny. Can you bring up, I don't know if they have, bring up Frosty, Heidi, and Frank.
How are they all able to do this?
And maybe bring it up on Instagram.
Yeah,
guys.
That's what.
Bring
it's
up, anyway,
literally
anyway,
just.
Kicking bottles down?
Let me finish. So then Frosty does it, and he goes to kick it after everyone's done it, and we'll show it. Just go to Instagram, because it's really worth watching. Yeah, that's it. Let's go to – well, I'll show you – yeah, let's look at – so where's Sammy's? So go, that's – okay, that's Johnny's. Bring that up, because there's a bunch of them in that same
slide.
One.
Yeah.
It's a slide. So let's go to the next one. That's Johnny Ice, our old engineer. All right, that's Sammy. All right, push play. All right, so here's Sammy.
Oh my God! They got a bottle of Jefferson's.
Is it not playing?
We hit play.
Oh, okay. Try again. Uh-oh, what happened?
Playing again.
All right, try again.
I just want y'all to pay attention to that bottle of Malort
that's
sitting there.
Yeah,
that is a Chicago.
Booty.
Booty.
I need the booty.
Yeah.
It appears it's not playing.
All right, let's see if Frosty's. Frosty's is the last one. I hope the Frosty's last one. Last one. There. Nope. There it is. Okay. Ah.
Do you know that I have no idea what they look like?
Technology.
This is the first time I've ever seen them.
There you go. Technology.
It's just yeah.
But anyway,
just...
he doesn't even clear the bottle. He like hits the bottom of the bottle. It doesn't even get close to the
top. I don't understand how the rest of them did it.
They all did it. Every single one of those people did it except Frosty.
Are they holding the bottle?
No. They all did it. Every single one of them did it except Frosty. And it's amazing to watch. So you go to the FHF show on Instagram and watch those videos and tell them that Clara Live sent you.
And also make sure you try to get some Jepson's Malort. It is a Chicago staple.
It's awful.
It tastes like death.
Engine fluid.
But it's just something you got to have.
Oh,
but
it's engine fluid. All right, can we let's get to thank you so much. Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Hey, you guys there?
Yeah, we're here. You're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Hey, this is Jesse from Nebraska.
Jesse, what's
hey,
up?
Jesse.
What do you got for us
Hi,
today?
Jesse.
Hey, Jesse.
I love that name.
Hold on. I'm in a truck right now. I got to call somebody on the CB.
All right, thanks for the call, Jesse. All right,
he
so
said he got a what?
I don't know.
He was a troll?
He got to call somebody on CB.
Yeah, we don't have time for that. Yeah. All right, let's...
What's that mean?
He on the radio.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
10-4, good buddy. We're going to come around the band
you know
here.
What, Jesse,
no time for that.
We'll hold.
Like,
no.
Hey,
fine,
good
Jesse,
buddy,
let's
you
got
to hold on for a second. I got Collider Live on the line.
We're on a live show right now. Let's just hold for Jesse.
And you're
Everybody
CB.
Hold.
We'll take another one, Cody, when you're
on hold.
Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
Cool. Still Jesse.
We're on the CB.
Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got? Perfect.
This is going swimmingly.
So far,
good
0 for
show.
2. 0 for 2. And I feel so. Hey, you're on Collider Live. Who do we got?
This is it, I believe.
Hey, it's Kevin from Frisco.
Hey, there brother. So, what do you got for us today?
Well, I got two possible questions. It's a wrestling or a video game to movie.
Sure.
So, like, what would you rather hear?
Let's start with the wrestling, and then we'll go to the video game. We'll give you both. What do you got?
Okay. Well, I mean, just in general, did you or Jay get the chance to watch Fyter Fest yet? And just thoughts on the show?
I did not. I had to work that. I had to get ready for work. I had a bunch of stuff that I had to work that night, so I didn't get a chance to see it. I was mad I didn't.
It was free, right?
It was free. It was on BleacherReport.com, and I heard it was another good show. And I just heard the big thing was this chair shot that Cody took from John Moxley.
So, what have you heard about this chair shot? Because after we talked about it on the air, I heard that it was a gimmick chair.
So, first of all, there's no way you can gimmick a chair. I just want to say that's something to shut people up.
Right.
It's not like breakable glass.
No,
yeah,
a steel chair is a steel chair.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, the shot is just taken. Yeah. Unfortunately, you know, people are going to have their way they feel about it. Like, oh, you shouldn't take those shots. But I kind of get what Cody is going for. He wants to put over this product as much as possible.
And have people talking about it.
And have people talk. No matter how you feel about it, people are talking
about
it.
So if he had asked you about it, would you have said to do it?
Yep. I've taken kendo stick shots to the head. I've taken steel chairs to the head several times. So.
What is a kendo stick?
Singapore cane. You know, the bamboo, long bamboo.
Oh, those things. Yeah.
Knapsack did that on me once. And whew.
Yeah, Knapsack used to get blasted with those things when he was wrestling. All right, what about your video game question?
So the way I've felt about it, especially more recently, and granted, we still need to see a trailer for it, but seeing the first look at The Witcher, I've been growing more and more that video games should go the TV route instead of 100%. Movies, at least most of them.
Yeah.
I mean, do you guys kind of feel that way?
100%. I couldn't.
Give me a Legend of Zelda TV series.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't understand how Hollywood couldn't have figured this out sooner. It just translation-wise, it makes so much more sense.
More
to
hours
do episodes,
of material.
More hours, character development. Like, having it in a movie, what are you doing?
Did anybody ever see the, Mortal Kombat series they did?
It
for
was
a while?
So good.
It was great.
Really?
No.
They're making that into a movie.
Who did it? It's on YouTube.
It was Machinima back in the day, right?
It was great because it was hourly. It wasn't forcing everything into one episode.
Well, that goes back to exactly what we were talking about with the Mandalorian, right? They're gonna get. I mean, that's just the original stuff that they're coming up with. And that's 8 hours that you get to any time that you have a lot of material that you can then spawn into something like even Lord of the Rings. Okay, New Line wanted to make that movie. Or Warner Brothers wanted to make that movie. A 2.5 hour movie, all three of them back in the day.
Yeah.
And then maybe two. Yeah, Peter Jackson's like, no, this needs to be three. And they're like, no, this will be one movie. And he's like, bye bye. Mm-hmm. And he took off. So that was for three movies. And you look at, like, even with J.A. Bayona, that series is going to just do, and that's not even with a lot of the Tolkien stuff. That's going to be a lot of new stuff that they have. It gives you more opportunity to expand on characters, expand on lore.
Do you think that's going to be an issue to the diehard fans, though? Because a lot of stuff that will be, just added in for the element of the show.
No, because I think that they're going to understand that. Because in a movie, it's like, oh, you only had 2 hours of stuff, and you made up all the stuff. You didn't even put in some of the great stuff. But when you have 8 hours, it's like, oh, we have 8 hours of stuff. They're going to add new things.
Okay.
Even the Game of Thrones fans that when they were following the books, they were also very aware that you have to add new things inside of it because it's television. You're like, okay, well, they stuck a lot to the books, and then they added some new things, and that stuff worked. I think you're going to see a lot of that, and with video games, you can play off of that because you can't just assume that everyone's played the game, right? You can use a lot of the things that were there before that made the game special.
The other example I think that works is The Walking Dead. It works as a comic book series. It works as a TV series, it also – what?
You said The Walking Dead is something on the notes.
This is something on the notes.
Oh, okay. And it also works as a video game. It works in all those spaces because it's about the characters and the basic premise and then just living in it. And I believe if they had originally made The Walking Dead comic book series just into a straight-up movie, it would not be nearly as successful.
I don't think we need Fear the Walking Dead TV show. I really don't think we need.
And a third one that's coming?
Let's end the
show today with this story. What is The Walking Dead thing?
So the comic series by Kirkman has been going on for many, many years, and it came to a surprise end.
It's done.
Wow. And it was they had already released cover art for like the last two, but it was it just kind of happened. And Kirkman went out there and said, I love it when you lose track of like the story. Game of Thrones, he brought up, mentioned it when you're in the movie theater and you're like, and you start to feel the ending coming and you're like, it takes you out of the movie. He's like, I wanted to just really get it and just end it on a note that felt
right.
Can we give a
spoiler warning and then do you know how it ends?
I do not know how it ends. No, yeah.
But I always kind of love this because we're so involved in this world. I remember when on spoiler for Grey's Anatomy. I remember on Grey's Anatomy when we lost Derek, who had been there for Meredith Grey.
Yeah. It broke my heart.
Being serious, it was an absolute shock.
Yeah.
When George died, it hurt me.
No, that was crushing too. George but died everybody knew that was we knew that.
Yeah,
was
yeah but I didn't know what was going on.
McDreamy, we did not know.
Yeah, McDreamy was the one, like, fuck.
Couldn't believe it.
You guys are all making fun of me.
I watched Grey's Anatomy.
Still to this day?
I haven't caught up in a while, but I was watching it.
When he died,
I watched one with the hospital.
Are you guys going to let me make my point or are you not?
No. Yes, go. Go.
No, I'm
struggling through this heat.
I'm with you on this, okay?
It was so much more satisfying. I'm done. I'm tapped out.
See? Doesn't feel good.
I don't do it to you. It's them. Do you listen to the show? It's Josh.
Throwing him under the bus. Yo, shows. Good news happened here, guys. Good news happened
good
here
news
today
happened
on the show.
Sure
Thank did. You so much for Grey's Anatomy coming to an end. And we are also coming to an end today. Thank you to Jay Washington.
Thank you for having
Where
me.
Where can they go get tickets to go watch?
Go to UEWWrestling.com. UEWWrestling.com. It's Saturday at the Metroflex Sports Center in Long Beach. 3200 East 59th Street.
Go support Jay. And if you can't be there in person, you can check out his Patreon and watch it there. That's what I'll be doing. So, guys, make sure that you follow us here on the Collider Live YouTube channel. Subscribe to us, obviously, and on podcasts, wherever podcasts can be found. And get those tickets, man. The SchmodownLive.com. You're going to see Rachel Cushing against Mike Kalinowski. And we're going to find out the Comic-Con schedule this weekend. So on Monday, we'll find out exactly what the hell's going on, who the undercard is. Talk to you on Friday. Short pre-tape show.